Let's stand for the scripture reading and prayer. God, we just thank you for another opportunity. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand. Help these women since they have contended in my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. I've just read to you Philippians 4, verses 1 through 3. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his word. Testimony service is now open to those who want to testify or sing a song of praise. You may do so at this time.
And
yes,
one word at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord.
Thank you.
Don't you know that God will hold you in the midnight hour and say it's all right, man?
Oh, yes.
It's all right, Pastor Ray. It's all right, Sister Cynthia. It's all right, Will Wilson out there. It's all right. Get somebody, just take your name and say, it's all right.
Thank you.
Say hold up.
Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3 through 8. And it reads, "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. The voice said, cry, and he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the godliness thereof is as of the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever." Title of the message this morning is "Keep the Grass Cut Low So You Can See the Snakes Crawl." Yes. Right. Feel not like time, we tend to keep our lives, our minds, as well as our hearts cluttered and overwhelmed with a lot of stuff that's meaningless, time consuming, unfruitful, and that bring no hope or promise. And most of these things have nothing to do with our destiny or our purpose in life, let alone the plan and purpose that God has for our lives. We connect ourselves with people and get into situations that cause grief, pain, hurt, frustration, minor as well as major setbacks in our lives. Some of these setbacks we recover from quickly, and some take a while and result in delays. And God forbid us never living a purpose-driven life. In our text today, we have the prophet Isaiah, who was considered as one of the greatest prophets of the Bible. Now, I personally believe that every prophet of the Bible and everybody that wrote something in the Bible is great, because each person was inspired to write a word by God. They were used to deliver and demonstrate a message directly from our Father. And their prophecies are still being fulfilled today. Now, Isaiah lived in Jerusalem, and the prophecies that God gave him were directly for Israel, for God's people. Now, in Isaiah 1, in chapter 39, Isaiah points out the sins of both the north and the south kingdoms. He tells them of a severe punishment coming to them and all the nations around them. What I find familiar about this story is that the punishment was not only for the ones whom he sent, or he was sent to prophesy to, but it would affect all the people that were around. This is why we have to be careful who we hang around, as well as not to be a hindrance or a stumbling block for others. The Bible tells us that what you join yourself to, you become. And also reminds me of the old saying, misery loves company. So what we or others do can have a negative and sometimes a positive effect on you as well as those around you. But what I love about God is that he always gives a solution and a resolution to all of our problems. He says, "Wash yourselves and make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your deeds from my sight. Cease to do evil." Later he tells of the great hope of the coming Savior. He says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and her son, and he shall call his name Emmanuel, meaning God with us." He says, "Prepare the way." The word "prepare" means to get things in order, to set up, to get ready, to organize, to modify. We must get our hearts leveled, being unwavering. We have to be steady, and our hearts have to be changed. We do this by removing clutter, waste, garbage, cleaning up everything in us and around us. When we want to get our house in order, we start spring cleaning. Not only do we clean and organize the inside, but we go outside as well. Because how many of you know that even though you clean up the inside of your house real, real clean, when somebody passes by and the outside is all cluttered and all messed up, it kind of makes them think that that's what it looks like on the inside. The Bible tells us to be careful who we connect ourselves to. Now, one of the first things that we do in the outside of our own houses is that we begin to cut the grass. We cut the grass so that you can be able to see the beauty of my own home. And not only do we just cut the grass, but some of us edge to make it look pretty, to make it look nice. Because I want to present to you or make you think or make you see what may be on the inside. And a lot of times I know people tell us that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. So what you see, and sometimes you may see things and it may be beautiful, but because of what's inside of your heart, they make you see it as ugly. If the outside is a mess and the grass is high, we can't see or we can't recognize the beauty that's on the inside.
Amen.
So I think that each person should constantly take a self-evaluation and a self-examination of themselves.
Amen.
You know, we are quick to, and it's easy for us to go and clean somebody else up. I can find your faults. I can tell you what's wrong with you. I can tell you what you need to fix. But all the while I'm pointing that one finger at you, three are pointing back at myself. The Bible tells us, judge not lest ye be judged. But a lot of people come and say that you're judging them because you're looking at the fruit that they're presenting. They say, I'm an apple tree, but I have nothing but oranges and thorns on my tree. So you can't be what you say you are. So that's not judging. I'm just recognizing a tree by its fruit.
Amen.
The Bible tells us to know them that labor among you, especially when you're in God. You got to be careful of the people that come with mess.
Amen.
One thing that we do in the household of God, and one thing our main purpose should be, is winning souls. The Bible says a wise man wins souls, but there are so many people that are so concerned with your personal life, what you look like, how you dress, what you drive, where you live, what you're doing for God. So I don't know about you, but my daily prayer is for people. I pray that every person and every man repents and turns to God. And not only am I praying for you, but I'm praying for myself as well. Because I may just be one sin away from hell. So everybody that says, Lord, Lord, don't mean that they are of God. So you got to see the fruit that they bear. If you around somebody that's always worried about what the next person is doing, always ready to say how they need to go correct somebody, then I need to find out what's really going on with you. Are you perfect or are you God? Because the last time I checked, there was only one God.
Amen.
And that's one who will judge me, and that is God. So you finish taking your Simonex and stay up all night long watching me. Because while you watching me, I'm steadily going to be laying up my timber trying to make it to heaven. I've never been the type to have a whole bunch of friends. Never had a whole bunch of people hanging around me. Because sometimes you got to watch it. Because the more friends you have, the more mess you get. And I'm kind of skeptical of somebody that always got to come tell me something about what somebody else been said. But you forgot to tell me what you were saying. Yeah. Wisdom has taught me that the bigger and the more cluttered your surroundings are, the more open and likely you are to being affected by, or overcome, or possessed by different evil spirits. So I gotta be careful, and I watch who I connect myself to. I listen to your conversation. And if your conversation ain't edifying God, if you ain't talking about the assignment that God has for you, not your assignment, I'm talking about the assignment that God has, and it does with winning souls, we ain't got no conversation. I find that people stay in battles, they stay in storms, and they stay in trouble when they have a whole lot of people. I got to run, get me a prophecy. Tell me what the Lord is saying. If you open your Bible, the Lord will tell you himself. Jesus showed the perfect example when he met a man named Jairus. He was a ruler of the synagogue, of the house of worship. He fell at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house because he had a 12-year-old daughter who was dying. There were so many people around with needs. They were all waiting on Jesus to heal them, to deliver them, to help them. And I don't care how big or how small your problem may be. All problems, all sicknesses, all storms, all trials are big when they're yours. People may look at my storm and say, hey, that's a piece of cake, baby. I can handle that at any time. But you don't know how heavy a person's storms and how heavy the things that they've been dealing with, how heavy it lies on them. Just because you may see one thing I'm dealing with, don't mean you really know what's really going on.
Yeah.
And sometimes a person can wear a smile on the outside and they're all tore up on the inside. See, I know what it feels like. I heard a song say, I know what it feels to lay in the bed at night and cry. Yeah. So you're not there. All you see is me coming in smiling and laughing, but you don't know what happens when I close my doors.
Hallelujah.
But you're quick to judge me. Oh, look at her. She has a friend. She's a demon and she's going to hell. Oh, she just smiled today. She's going to hell. Oh, her children are doing this and that. She's not a godly woman. How many people are at church today? Come count them. What that guy Salento say? Ooh, watch me, watch me, ooh, watch me. You wanna watch me?
Watch up. Watch up.
But it's funny. They wanna watch and talk about the negative things or the things they think is negative.
Yeah, yeah.
But do you know that on a daily basis, I try to encourage people?
Amen.
We're gonna tell that.
Yeah.
Amen.
Do you know that if I can, I will lend a helping hand and give the shirt off my back to anybody?
Yeah.
Go run, tell that.
Amen.
Even though this was a critical situation, Jesus still didn't stop what he was doing. My daughter is dying. People pressing him all over. There was a woman that came up to him with an issue of blood. She was down on her knees. And I don't know if all of you know what it feels like to lose a lot of blood. See, I know. And you get weak. Because I remember being down to 3 units of blood and I was almost crawling to the emergency room. So I know what she must have felt. But still, she pressed her way and touched the hem of Jesus' garment, and suddenly her issue stopped. See, a lot of us not trying to get to Jesus. We're trying to get big names for ourselves. Okay, maybe my name is Lisa. Spell it and make sure you spell it right. And even if you don't, I still don't care. Because I know who I am. You ever been in a situation so long that it dragged you to the ground? And you felt like life was draining out of you?
Amen.
I've been there. I live that almost every day. I'd be so frustrated almost every day. But I got to stay encouraged on the outside, and I got to keep smiling on the outside, because I don't want you to get discouraged. So I have to lay aside my own feelings. But people not talking about that. Yeah. They're worried about my personal life. Yeah. Well, if you all want to see my divorce papers, I'll show them to you. Now run tell that. People posting up stuff all over the internet about my life. Then Mr. Cynthia say, I'm a celebrity. Want to know what Lisa's doing? Well, baby, since 1996, I've been serving the Lord a long time. I'm not tired of it. I've been leading the Jesus a long time, and I'm not tired of it. Even after that, Jesus kept on ministering to the people. Because the Bible says that while he was still speaking, some of the rulers from the ruler's house came to him and told him, don't bother Jesus anymore. Your daughter is dead. A hopeless situation. Your back is against the wall. Bills due, no money to pay them. Doctor says there's no cure. You got one day to live. I done heard it all. I done been in the hospital and the doctor told my mama I had 10 days to live. 10 days. He said if she don't eat, she's gonna die. So a lot of you probably don't know that, because all you worried about is who I'm married to or who I'm with. I've been fighting for my life since the day I came to this earth. Seems like the enemy had an assignment to destroy me since the day I came out of my mother's womb saying, wah! I'm gonna get her. And I've been fighting. And I'm still here.
Amen.
It's not because I'm such a great person. It's because of his grace and mercy. And because he knows that regardless of what people try to do to me, nowhere, no matter what they say, I'm still going to do what the Lord called me to do. Jesus went on to Jairus' house. And when he got there, the people were crying and cutting up, and some of his disciples were probably full of doubt and everything, because you know Thomas was there, and he's the doubting Thomas. The Bible said Jesus put them all out except for the parents and three of his disciples. See, sometimes when you're going through, you will have to put some people out of your life. Because if you're not believing like I believe, if you're not going where I'm going, then you can't hang with me.
Amen.
Because see, I'm going to get everything that God has for me. And if you don't want yours, you can hand it over. Jesus tried to encourage the people by telling them the girl was asleep. And the Bible says they started laughing. You ever told somebody that you're believing that God is going to do this and that in your life, and this and that is going to happen in your life, and they start laughing at you?
Yeah. Yep.
To laugh on, because me and Jesus going to have the last laugh. All right. Sometimes you just have to encourage yourself.
Amen.
And I have to do that almost every day. Every day. If you only knew what I deal with on a daily basis. You only knew what I've been through. Some of the stuff that I went through, if you knew everything and every bit of my story, you would wonder, how am I still here today? How am I still able to have a smile on my face? See, I have 5 children. They don't follow me, I'll follow them anyway. They all have their own lives. I have 1,686 grandkids. And they all don't follow me. Because they all have their own life and their own agenda. And they can say all they want to, Lord, Lord, and God, I love God. But the Bible says it shows in your life.
Amen.
So your love towards one another, and the love you have towards one another will bring you into the house of the Lord. It will bring you to give God those few minutes. That ain't much. He said one day is like 1,000 years to him, so you don't even spend a whole day in the Lord's house. But we don't have time for that. And you think that's not discouraging? Do you think that that don't hurt me? But people be worried about the wrong thing. Because see, if people were really men and women of God, they would be praying for one another. Because the Bible says, pray without ceasing. Men should always pray. Always. See, I don't worry about what you're doing in your personal life. I don't worry about who you're connected to. I'm not worried about whatever sin you may be involved in. I'm worried about your destiny, your purpose. Somebody's going through and you try to encourage them. You try your best by saying it's not that bad. It's going to be okay. It's going to be all right. And I know on the inside of that person, because I know I've been feeling like, oh, shut up. No, it's not. I want to say, when? You don't know what I'm doing. We worry about the things we're losing. Worried about loved ones turning their backs on us. Turn your back, baby, but I'm going to continue to pray. Naked, I came into this world literally. And naked, I'm going to leave. I wasn't born with a Siamese twin. So I can't drag people to want to be in the right standing with God. I can't force you. All I can do is pray. And I'm not going to let nobody put nothing on my back that ain't on there. So you can continue to talk. You can continue to put me down. You can continue to look down at me. You can continue to talk. I don't care. Because I know who I am in God. And only God knows my heart.
That's right.
And if you did know my heart, people wouldn't be thinking or saying some of the things that they say. So you need to be confident in yourself and who you are in God. If you know that you're doing the right thing, you know that you're doing everything that you can do in your own power, in your own might, because see, this flesh, we got to wrestle against it every day. Every day. How hard it is not to get up and go knock on somebody's door and handle them? That was my life. I will go to your door and suffer the consequences later, because I have. I went to the door and got jumped on by everybody else up in the streets, but hey, I'm still here.
All right.
told all the doubters, all the ones without faith, to get out.
Yes.
He only left Peter, James, and John, and the mother and father. So in order to get a positive outcome, you have to be connected to positive people, positive situations, and people who believe like you believe. People that will speak life into your situation and into your spirit. And this is the same, you know, positive results for others. God is telling us to get our house in order. And we gotta first start off by cleaning ourselves up. There was this lady. And every day, she would look out of her window and she would be complaining about this woman and her dirty sheets that she hung on the line. Every day she would tell her husband, "I am so tired of this woman hanging these dirty sheets on the line. Don't she know how to wash them? If she comes to me, I'll teach her how to wash those sheets." So one day her husband said, "Let me go and see what she's talking about." So he went out and he saw that the sheets were white and clean. And he came back in and said, "Baby, ain't nothing wrong with them sheets. Your windows are dirty." See, sometimes you are looking at people and you're judging them because the truth is wrong inside of you. So before you judge me, go clean them sheets. Clean that window. Make sure your house is in order. Come and straighten me out. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You know, sometimes we have so many mountains in our lives. So many things that are cluttering our lives. And sometimes these hindrances and these mountains are family and friends and they're close to you.
Amen.
So I just remember the song said, "Lord, you don't have to move my mountain, but give me the strength to climb. And Lord, don't take away my stumbling blocks, but lead me all around. Bye.
God to remove some things and to think seriously about your life. And we ask Brother Lewis to come forward as he was just a camera before. Amen.
I know it was the blood.